Poverty and a lack of alternative livelihoods thus also identified in many countries. We need to make sure that people in and around forests are able to make a livelihood, to have a buen vivir, you know, and still do that in harmony with the forest. And sometimes, yes, that does require support. Not massive amounts of money, but very targeted, integrated support. And climate change, and so-called natural disturbances like forest fires and floods that are having storms that are heavily being increased now by climate change. But we need, I mean, forests are not threatened so much by the lack of rain, they are threatened by climate change. You know, we could reach the tipping point in 10 years of some of the major forest ecosystems on this planet, you know, and then it's too late to save them. So, but this process needs to do is first and foremost have a strong climate change regime, and any rhetoric proposal that undermines the climate change regime will not help forests or forest people, period. So we need to address this. And all this boils together on this major root cause of neoliberal economic policy that lock in unsustainable consumption and poverty. As they said at the workshop in India, very clear, you know, you can't have unlimited growth on a limited planet. And if we don't address that fundamental issue here at the Climate Change Convention, you know, we will never solve this problem. This planet is limited. We cannot continue to grow. Impossible. So let me talk about the positive story now. Why are forests like here in Brazil, Mata Atlantica, still there? What are the root causes of forest conservation and forest restoration? First of all, what we found all over the world is that there are so many examples of community conserved areas and indigenous territories where the indigenous peoples have conserved and restored their forests. These are the examples, and Charles will actually give a more in-depth example of this, that we need to foster and to promote in any kind of forest policy. You know, because it's not just about that. It's about what do we do to challenge this to meet this challenge of addressing deforestation in all these different forest fora. Why would they do this? I move that. Because a lot of these people just feel that they are the custodians of Mother Earth, especially indigenous peoples, but also communities. First and foremost, it's in their value systems to conserve forests. Now, we can, you know, help them with finding alternative livelihoods so they can live up to this. But this concept of paying for an environmental service, as if it's totally okay to denude a forest whenever you're not paid for it, it has totally corrupted 20 years of forest discussions. Now, forest, saving forest is not an environmental service. It's something we're supposed to do, and then, yes, we should actively share, you know, the burden and the benefits of that. Another thing I just briefly want to mention, the awareness that forests are important for water was a very important motivation for a lot of people, including, for example, in countries like Brazil and Kenya, and very successful forest projects based on that. And now, lastly but not leastly, for the good news, we do not need a lot of money. In none of the workshops it was said, well, these forests are really lost because we don't have billions of money. What we do need is a bit of support, but it should be very targeted and integrated with the implementation of the Millennium Development Goals, providing alternative livelihoods to people and supporting what is good, but the success stories. What we do need for that is political will, and that is something, you know, of course, this climate process in an integrated, comprehensive deal can provide. So last but not least, that's why we do not support a separate red decision here. Forests will first and foremost die by climate change if we do not have a comprehensive, very strong climate agreement with drastic emission cuts. Forests will be less. Thank you very much.